So in this video, guys, we've got some really interesting stuff to look at. This is stuff that I get really excited about because I love lighting. So we're going to be considering different types of light source, so the different kinds of lights that we can use as electricians. We'll be looking at filament lighting, also known as incandescent lighting. We'll be looking at fluorescent lighting in both its compact form and the tubular form, the more traditional form, and also LED lighting, which is obviously exciting because that's the wave of the future. We'll also consider the different types of connection that are available to electricians, and we'll talk particularly, there's one particular thing we're interested in with that, Gaz, what's that?
We're interested in, for both being an electrician and obviously for the exam, is whether the lamp itself has polarity. Yeah. So we've got to work that out. And as we move towards a level 3 test inspection course, whether that be for AM2 or AM2S, there's always going to be a light fitting that has polarity, and it has to be confirmed by the electrician. And we'll look at that as well in this video. Yeah.
So obviously this is the entry point for studies regarding lighting. There will be future videos covering things in a lot more depth. There'll even be some mathematical stuff that we've got to do with calculating lighting levels and things like that. So we'll bring the camera in and we'll have a look at what we've got here on the bench.
Let's do that.
So we've got a number of lamps laid out on the bench here. We're going to consider some different ones. So the first one that we're going to look at is this here, the tungsten filament lamp, or incandescent lamp. This lamp has been around for about 100 years now, and it works very simply. Inside here, there is a tiny filament of wire. That wire is made out of a material called tungsten, and when we pass current through that piece of tungsten wire, it starts to get very, very hot, and eventually it glows white hot and it gives off light. Now, the downside to this particular type of lamp is that it needs to get hot to work, which means that it gives off a lot of heat. Now, this is very wasteful because as well as giving off some light, this lamp also emits a lot of waste heat. In fact, they're so inefficient, they're more like little heaters that give off some waste light. In order to stop the filament burning out too quickly, we enclose this inside this glass bulb that goes on the outside, and that bulb is filled with argon gas, which is an inert gas, and will help to stop the filament from reacting with the oxygen in the air and from burning out too early. So over to my glamorous assistant and we'll see the colour of that lamp.
So we can see there, when the electrical current's being passed through the filament itself, that it glows. But the downside, as Joe just said, as we leave it on for a few minutes, that this will get very warm, very hot. So that energy is therefore wasted. So therefore we've evolved onto different types of lamps and are more efficient lamps that we're looking at nowadays.
Yeah, you might find it hard to come across a filament lamp these days because they're gradually being phased out as time goes on because of their inefficiency. So we have then the cousin to the filament lamp, the tungsten filament lamp. We've got here a halogen lamp. Now you'll notice inside this outer glass bulb here, we've got a smaller lamp inside there, and inside that is a filament, very similar to the one that we've got that Gary's unscrewing now. And that filament will still glow, it will still get hot, it will give off some white light. However, the difference with this is that inside that little capsule inside there, there is halogen gas. And the way that works is that the halogen gas actually helps to kind of keep recycling the filament, the tungsten in there, and means that that lamp will actually last for a lot longer, which makes it slightly more efficient than its cousin, the filament lamp. Shall we have a look at that one, Gaz?
Drop that one in as well.
See what that looks like.
So we turn that one on.
So you can see again, how's that behaving, Gaz?
Yeah, so again, exactly the same as before. We're passing electrical current through an element, and again, it will get hot. So there will be some wasted energy with this style of lamp.
Very good. So we'll now look at our third type of light source. So about, 15 years ago, it was... A big push was made to try and start reducing the amount of energy that we're using in different places in the electrical industry. So filament lamps were started to be phased out, and this type of lamp was introduced, the compact fluorescent lamp. Now the way this works is slightly more complicated, but basically current passes through this tube, which again is filled with a type of gas, and actually will then start to give off a UV light, which is invisible to humans. But the inside of the tube is coated with a phosphorescent powder. And as the UV light hits that phosphorescent powder, it glows with a nice white light and it gives off light that we can see by. So we'll plug that one in.
These take a while to warm up. So in other words, when you turn them on initially into a room, it doesn't seem as if there's a lot of light output, and over a period of a couple of minutes that we actually increase that light output. So let's turn this one on. So So there we see. And we can see when people moved over to them, there was a fantastic that we were saving energy, but the quality of the light in the room was actually diminished by the fact that we were obviously saving energy. Yeah. Maybe this was around 15 watts, and you may have replaced a 60 watt lamp with that. So you got the energy benefits from it, but the light output wasn't as good.
Yeah, I'd agree with everything you've said there, Gaz. Admittedly, there's been great strides with the technology over those recent years. They warm up quite quicker. The light output is nicer. However, it's to do with the frequency of the light output, really, that, that makes it sort of a less pleasant light to live by rather than to work by. In an office, you know, fluorescent lighting works a treat, but in the home, it's not ideal. Now, because of that, partly because of that, the industry started to drive towards alternative light sources. And now we're looking at this type of light source. And this type of light source is one that is really taking over now as the main source of light for people. It's an LED light. So LED stands for light emitting diode. Again, there's some very kind of deep-seated physics going on here, which explains why this works. So we're not going to go into that into too much detail now. But basically, we pass a current through these LEDs, and they give off a bright white visible light, which is, it's got a number of advantages. It can be tuned quite nicely to give off the kind of white light very similar to a filament lamp, so it looks quite nice. And there's various different ones available. Just a word of warning, if you're going to use LED lighting, always buy quality ones, make sure you go for that. And if it's something for in the home, often a warm white is better than a cool white because it gives off a more filament type glow. Shall we have a look at that one in action, Gaz?
Yeah, we'll do. So we've popped those ones out. I've done a video on this where I just showed the actual effect of taking out a compact fluorescent lamp and replacing it with an LED in my daughter's bedroom. So let's turn this one on. Okay, I think between the two you possibly can see that now it's slightly brighter. And also there is another reduction in the wattage output. So this is probably around about 4 watts, where this one was around 15 watts. This was around 60 watts. So you can see how energy is being saved. And also the lamp itself gets only mildly warm. There's no massive amount of heat being generated by this type of lamp.
Yeah. I think it's fair to say this one comes with a little word of warning. If you do have fluorescent lights in your house, Gaz, do we want to go out and start replacing our fluorescent lights with LED lights?
Absolutely not. This has got a carbon footprint from its manufacturer. So it's been made, you've bought it, you're using it. Only when it's expired, its life's expired, should we then look to replace it with an LED. Otherwise, we're just chucking away at the carbon footprint of this lamp.
Yeah, I think that's a fair shout.
So for a quick overview of the different styles of lamps that we have in front of us here, we're now going to concentrate on looking at the actual end connecting points. So the first lamps that we possibly looked at were these style here. We've got the Edison screw and the small Edison screw using exactly the same principle. So we've got a screwed section here, which is connected to one of our conductors, and a center contact, which is connected to another one of our conductors. Joe, do you want to explain what they're connected to for me, please?
Yeah, sure. So when we look at an Edison screw type cap, as Gary says, we've got two points of contact, the actual thread, and then we've got this point of contact on the end. Now, it's really important, and as you progress through level two and up to level three, you'll understand it's really important that this center contact here is always connected to the line conductor. That's absolutely critical. And therefore the outer thread here will be connected to the neutral, and the idea behind that is that when you start screwing this into a light fitting, if your finger slips down and touches this metal part, you're touching a neutral connection rather than a line connection.
And therefore there's a massive risk of electric shock. Yeah. So the customer's holding on to this part, which is connected to a line conductor, and they will receive an electric shock.
Yep.
And then we've got this style here, so we've got it on both the compact fluorescent and the halogen lamp. We've got the Bayonet cap. This time we have two points of contact on the top, on both of them, two points of contact. And this one here and this one here, exactly the same. Principle behind it is that they have what we call no polarity. So in other words, it doesn't matter which one of these contacts is connected to the line conductor and which one of these is connected to the neutral conductor. And that's the same in both cases, slightly different contact points, but again, it doesn't matter if this one is the line conductor and this one is the neutral. We say these style of lamps, Bayonet cap lamps, have no polarity.
Yeah, so again, this part on the Bayonet cap, that doesn't connect to anything at all. There's no electrical connection there. It's just these two pins. And it makes perfect sense that this doesn't have polarity, because when you change an electric lamp in your house, you just plug it in and twist it. You don't think about getting it in the right way around here. You just plug it in however it will go.
Absolutely. So in summary then, we've gone through the original tungsten filament. Mm-hmm. We've looked at the halogen lamps, the compact fluorescent, mm-hmm. and the more modern now LED lamp. Yep. And we've done a small discussion on the style of caps, in these cases, the Edison screw and the Bayonet cap. We will develop this on in further videos. Do you agree, Joe?
Absolutely, yeah. Lots more to think about.
Yeah, I think we'll break down the fluorescent light fitting, we'll look at lux levels, etc.
Yep.
So, I think we're going to start to say it without actually being in shot.
We hope this video has been some help.